Good afternoon. If you could please take your seats so we can get off to a slightly delayed but still energetic start. I'm Jim Hoagland, and this particular session is to discuss an enduring mystery so far, the American presidential transition, the post-election of Donald J. Trump in the United States. We have a distinguished panel to discuss this question. We'll start with two former ambassadors from Europe and from Asia to Washington, who know the American society well. That will come in very handy since we Americans are still puzzled by what we've managed to do to and for ourselves with the election of Mr. Trump. This is going to be necessarily a very impressionistic exercise, since there are very few hard and clear facts yet about the transition from Barack Obama to Donald Trump as president. The only rule for Mr. Trump so far in his transition seems to be that there are no rules. He will do pretty much as he did in the campaign what he thinks is the right thing to do. And we will have to figure it out, in many cases, post facto. I think we have about 60 days to go, which is going to be very much a process of trial and error on the part of our president-elect. We will then move from our two ambassadors to two eminent businessmen, one from Mexico, one from Korea, who will give us their sense of how the global economy is likely to respond to Mr. Trump's initiatives as far as we can deduce them. And finally, we have two public intellectuals, one from Serbia and one from China, to discuss the world of ideas in Donald J. Trump. And to conclude, we have a young American working very much in the technological blogosphere to give us a sense of what it might mean for the future. We'll have the usual presentations and then we'll move to a question and answer section. First of all, I'd like to introduce François Bujon de Letang. He was president of the FBE International Consultants, an old friend from Washington, and a distinguished viewer of the American scene. François.
Thank you for this introduction. Is this thing working? Yes, it is. Good. I'm very intimidated with the duty to start on such a distinguished panel. Everybody has heard about everything possible about Mr. Trump, but before I give you a few impressions from Europe on this election, I'd like to come back briefly to Trump's election and to give a few thoughts on what made it possible. The first thing I think we should dwell on is that it was, of course, Trump's victory, but it was also Hillary's defeat. And I think there are lessons to be drawn from that. Trump's victory, of course, Trump approached the campaign and the election as a complete political outsider, and he led a campaign against, really, political correctness, against Washington, against the establishment, against the political class as we know it. His campaign was built on the anger and frustration in the American electorate that was felt mostly by what we call the angry white men, people cast aside by globalization, sometimes having lost many things, even sometimes their home in the 2008, 2009, in a crisis, the neglected white electorate, contrary to Hillary, who tried to cater to the three categories of voters who had elected Obama in 2008 and re-elected him in 2012, the young people, the women, and the minorities. Trump ignored these three categories and campaigned really to a different set of the electorate who usually are not voting, but whom he was able to channel and mobilize with methods from reality TV, of which he was a star, more than of a typical political campaigner or orator. But that's Trump. Hillary, on the other side, brought with her a feeling of déjà vu and suffered from the Clinton fatigue that has affected the American electorate. She was the incarnation of everything that Trump and his voters were rejecting. She led a relatively poor campaign, probably weaker than in 2008, and she was not an ideal candidate. She might have been a good president, but she was not a very good candidate, honestly. She lost the Electoral College, which normally she shouldn't have lost, because if you have the total of delegates from the states that voted consistently for the Democratic Party for the last six elections, she had 242 such candidates that she could count on. She could have won one or two swing states and been elected. She didn't win one of the big swing states, and she lost several of the key consistently Democratic states like Pennsylvania, for instance, or Michigan. And I think the most impressive figure about her defeat is that she commanded 10 million less votes than Obama in 2008. 10 million less. That election leaves many, many questions unanswered. Many questions about Trump himself. What kind of a president will he be? We know what kind of a candidate he has been, but a few things have indicated that he might try to be a different president than a candidate. We can leave him the benefit of the doubt for a few weeks at least. But there are many, many concerns. First, the arch conservative followers that he has, some of them already appointed to key positions, the role that his family will play, and his character, who is certainly difficult to deal with. So that's about Trump himself. About the divided Republican Party, we also have a number of unanswered questions. The Republican Party was sort of hijacked by Donald Trump. A number of its leaders really didn't support him. And if you think about it, many of the slogans on which he campaigned ran directly contrary to the typical Republican doxa. So what kind of real following will he have in Congress with a Republican Party that is so heavily divided remains a mystery and might hamper his action. Many questions also about a deeply divided America that really was the background of this election. It is not new, but it is increasing. The divisions are many, and I cannot even list them. The problem of social cohesion, obviously, is a major problem in America. We've seen this through the Trump campaign. We have a deep division between the conservative right that is really calling the shots and more moderate Republicans and, of course, we would say centrists in Europe. Hillary got 1 million more voters in the popular vote than Trump, so he was not at all elected by a landslide. It is a clean victory, but a narrow one in terms of voters, and it shows a deeply divided American society. It was as Washington against the rest, and if you look at the electoral map, you see that the whole American continent is red, with the exception of the two coasts that remain blue. So these are all clear indications of deep divisions. That's for the election itself. Now, if we turn to Europe and how Europe feels and how it considers the perspectives of a Trump presidential term, I would then switch to French, because I think I can speak in English about things American, but about things European, I prefer to express myself in my own language. La victoire de M. Trump a été évidemment une complète surprise en Europe et un coup de tonnerre. Une complète surprise, c'est normal parce que les sondages ne le laissaient pas
ne le laissait pas escompter. On a beaucoup fait le procès des sondeurs à cette occasion, mais aussi parce que les Européens, non seulement escomptaient une victoire de Hillary Clinton, mais ils espéraient une victoire de Hillary Clinton, au fond. Hillary Clinton, il la voyait dans la continuité du mandat de son mari. C'est une femme qui connaît l'Europe, qui connaît bien les enjeux des relations internationales, et ils avaient en elle beaucoup plus de confiance qu'ils n'en avaient en Obama, par exemple. Les Européens ont été souvent inconfortables avec l'administration Obama, et il pensait qu'avec Hillary, il y aurait une sorte de normalisation et un espèce de retour des États-Unis sur la scène européenne. Mais cette victoire de Trump a été en fait un coup de tonnerre, parce qu'elle intervient dans un contexte qui est difficile pour les Européens, pour des raisons à la fois proprement européennes et pour des raisons transatlantiques. Les raisons proprement européennes, vous les connaissez tous, c'est que l'état de l'économie en Europe est mauvais, la croissance est très faible, le chômage reste très élevé, l'eurozone, qui a fait face avec succès à des crises ces derniers temps, reste quand même exposée à diverses fragilités, notamment dans le domaine bancaire. Le Brexit apporte évidemment de nouveaux sujets d'interrogation et montre très bien la fragilité d'une construction européenne dont, pour la première fois, un membre a pu décider de sortir. Et le Brexit encourage évidemment la montée des populismes dont il a été une expression. Voilà, tout ça, ce sont les raisons pour lesquelles les Européens se trouvent déjà dans une situation inconfortable au moment de l'élection de Trump, pour des raisons proprement européennes. Mais il y a aussi des raisons transatlantiques. L'Europe a été très troublée par le mandat d'Obama. On ne le dit pas suffisamment. Obama a eu un immense succès en Europe parce que c'était le premier président noir de l'histoire des États-Unis, parce que c'était un homme distingué, parce que c'était un orateur prestigieux. Mais en même temps, Obama a été le premier président des États-Unis à n'avoir rien d'européen dans son ADN, je dirais. Cet homme né à Hawaï, élevé en Indonésie, qui se présente comme un homme du Pacifique, s'est désintéressé de l'Europe pendant son premier mandat et n'a commencé à s'y réintéresser pendant le second que parce que la Russie, par ses actions, l'avait obligé à se pencher sur l'Europe. Le pivot américain vers le Pacifique montrait bien la conviction profonde d'Obama, qu'il a exprimée lui-même, que l'avenir des États-Unis se jouerait à l'ouest, dans le Pacifique, beaucoup plus qu'à l'est en Europe. Et les Européens étaient inconfortables avec cela. Ajoutons à ça que le climat à proprement parler transatlantique n'était pas très bon. Les négociations sur le TTIP sont en panne, elles sont au moins en intensive care, sinon en coma prolongé. Et beaucoup de contentieux transatlantiques sont nés du fait de la volonté d'un certain nombre d'agences américaines et souvent du Congrès d'exercer une juridiction extraterritoriale, qui évidemment déplaît beaucoup aux Européens. Ça, c'est le background, si vous voulez. Mais l'élection de M. Trump suscite énormément d'inquiétudes en Europe. Quel sera son style? Quelle politique étrangère mènera-t-il? Personne n'en sait rien, mais tout le monde s'en inquiète, en réalité. Les inquiétudes, d'abord, portent sur des sujets spécifiques. Il y a d'abord un sujet macroéconomique qu'on commence à peine à souligner en Europe. Si M. Trump se lance dans un programme d'investissement massif dans les infrastructures publiques américaines, et il dépense des milliards en endettant davantage l'État américain, il risque de relancer l'inflation. Et qui dit relance de l'inflation, dit remontée des taux d'intérêt. Or, des pays très endettés, comme le mien par exemple, ne voient pas la perspective d'une remontée des taux d'intérêt sans une grande angoisse. C'est un premier sujet d'inquiétude. Mais il y en a d'autres. Il y a des inquiétudes sur le chapitre commercial, par exemple des négociations commerciales. M. Trump a fait ouvertement campagne contre le libre-échange et a annoncé son intention de ne pas ratifier le TPP, de démanteler l'ALENA. Donc toutes ces questions se posent. Va-t-il vraiment s'attaquer au libre-échange? Va-t-il adopter une politique protectionniste? Et si oui, n'y a-t-il pas risque de contagion? Inquiétude environnementale aussi. Il a annoncé son intention de dénoncer l'accord de Paris de la COP21 sur le climat, sur les changements climatiques, et comme c'était un des grands succès de l'administration Obama et de la politique étrangère française, c'est un sujet d'inquiétude manifeste. Sur la sécurité, les inquiétudes sont multiples. il a tenu sur l'OTAN et sur la garantie de sécurité de l'OTAN des propos peut-être tenus un peu à la légère, mais qui ont été considérés comme très inquiétants. Et bien entendu, les Européens de l'Est vivent avec la très très vive inquiétude que M. Trump pourrait se désolidariser de l'article 5 et se montrer beaucoup moins vigilant vis-à-vis des actions de la Russie qu'il ne devrait le faire. Va-t-il conclure un deal ? I'm a deal maker, dit-il. I can make a deal with this guy, en parlant de Poutine. Va-t-il chercher à faire un deal avec la Russie par-dessus la tête des Européens ? Jusqu'où va-t-il aller pour démanteler l'héritage d'Obama ? Ça, ce sont les inquiétudes spécifiques, je dirais, sectorielles, si vous voulez, des Européens. À ceci s'ajoute une inquiétude beaucoup plus générale, qui est une inquiétude sur le climat politique général. Monsieur Trump est la dernière incarnation de ce qu'on appelle le populisme, un mot que je n'aime pas parce que c'est un mot qui ne signifie pas grand-chose finalement, mais qui caractérise tout ce qui est contre la mondialisation, contre l'immigration, contre le libre-échange, tout ce qui s'adresse aux peurs ressenties souvent par les électorats. L'élection de Monsieur Trump peut constituer un puissant encouragement aux différents mouvements populistes qui déjà ont pris en Europe beaucoup de force. Il y aura un effet Trump, comme on dit, qui est absolument impossible à quantifier, mais que l'on va mesurer au fur et à mesure que se déroule le calendrier électoral de l'année 2017. Or, celui-ci est très inquiétant. Nous commençons le 4 décembre prochain par l'élection présidentielle autrichienne, dans laquelle un candidat d'extrême droite a des chances d'être élu, et par le référendum institutionnel italien. Nous aurons ensuite en mars des élections législatives aux Pays-Bas, dans lesquelles les populistes de M. Geert Wilders sont très forts, et M. Geert Wilders a assisté de façon très visible à plusieurs des meetings électoraux de M. Trump. Nous avons ensuite les élections présidentielles puis législatives en France au mois de mai et au mois de juin, et des élections législatives en Allemagne en octobre. Donc c'est une année qui est très propice justement à essuyer une montée des populismes qui ont déjà montré leur force avec le Brexit. Alors pour en terminer avec ces remarques introductives, les Européens bien entendu se trouvent devant beaucoup d'inconnus et beaucoup d'inquiétudes. Ils doivent d'abord et avant tout rester unis. Ils ont tenté de l'être quand ils se sont retrouvés pour la première fois sans le Royaume-Uni à Bratislava au mois de septembre. Les cinq présidents ou premiers ministres des principaux pays de l'Union européenne se sont retrouvés autour de Mme Merkel et de M. Obama à Berlin la semaine dernière et font montre d'unité, recherchent l'unité, notamment sur les valeurs démocratiques qu'ils entendent défendre. Il leur faudra également tenir bon sur le Brexit et se montrer intransigeant sur le respect des principes qui fondent l'Union européenne lorsque la négociation commencera après le mois de mars. La deuxième chose, c'est qu'il leur faut renforcer leur unité sur les sujets cruciaux. Il faut évidemment travailler à davantage de solidarité dans la construction de l'eurozone et surtout dans la politique migratoire, dans le renforcement de Schengen et dans le renforcement des contrôles aux frontières. Et puis, il leur faudra prendre en main leur sécurité, puisque une des choses qui ressortent le plus clairement des propos de M. Trump, c'est bien entendu la volonté de voir les alliés contribuer davantage à leur défense et à leur sécurité, ne pas compter sur les États-Unis, ne pas « enjoy a free ride from the United States ». Et dans ce domaine, il y a beaucoup à faire pour atteindre l'objectif de 2% de pourcentage des dépenses de défense par rapport au PNB qui a été déjà pourtant fixé par l'OTAN. Et il va falloir continuer à trouver le moyen de travailler avec le Royaume-Uni tout en travaillant aussi à négocier le Brexit. Tout ça va être difficile et les Européens qui n'avaient pas besoin de ce problème supplémentaire s'en inquiètent parce que la présidence de M. Trump leur cause beaucoup d'anxiété et risque par surcroît de compliquer beaucoup des sujets qu'ils ont par ailleurs à traiter. Voilà, mon cher Jim, ce que je
Merci, François. Merci. You nicely anticipated a question that I was going to ask, and that was simply what has what have these elections done to the image of America? And you've answered it very, very well. And I'd like the other panelists to also try to address that question as we go forward about what have these elections done to the image of the United States and what are the consequences. Our next speaker is the former ambassador of Japan to Washington, Mr. Ichiro Fujisaki.
J'ai toujours dit que l'élection présidentielle des États-Unis est un peu comme cadeau de Noël. Ça veut dire vous dites rien jusqu'au jour. Et le jour de Noël, comme ça vous pouvez dire, vous pouvez crier, c'est ce que j'ai voulu. N'est-ce pas? Et ce n'était pas exactement comme ça, mais dans tout cas, M. Abe a pu avoir le premier entretien avec M. Trump. Et non, ce n'était pas sur sujet spécifique. Il a parlé, je pense, que comment il se voit le vieux du monde, les relations avec la Russie, la Chine, la Corée, et Philippines, l'Inde, et aussi l'économie. Et je pense que c'était très important d'apporter la vue d'Asie, la vue alliée d'Asie directement à M. Trump le plus tôt possible. De ne mettre pas le place de demandeur. C'était très important pour nous. Et comme ça, je pense que tous les deux ont pu construire les relations de confiance. Et M. Trump, dans le Twitter, a dit qu'on a commencé une grande amitié. Et so, I will now change to English from here. I think Mr. Trump's election was very different from all other elections I have seen before. That was a menu, in short. So many different things on the menu. One was that lose the weight. The other was you have a rich dessert. It doesn't add up. Economists, Financial Times have written that it's not logic, but important thing was that ordinary people don't read those magazines, don't read those newspapers. It didn't matter at all. He was able to sing a song, music, which was good to each people. Now it's time that he has to cherry pick. I think there'll be three groups of policies. One, he will have to do it. Second, he will have to modify and do it. Third, he will postpone it. These three groups. The first group, I don't know which will be that. Second group, we are already seeing the walls is changing to fence, 11 million changing to 2 million. So maybe we could do that to second group. Also, about Obamacare, maybe that's going to be in second group. So we have to be seeing which one would go to group A, group B, group C. As for the foreign policy, I think maybe I'm too optimistic, but relations with Russia, China will not change fundamentally. Even if you like, if there's a personal chemistry, the country's relations are more important than personal chemistry, and it doesn't change fundamentally. If you levy China, it's not only against WTO, but your American consumer price would go up American competitivity would go down. You cannot do that so easily. Russia, you have more than 1,500 nuclear arsenals, both countries. You can't just go hug and forget about it. So in that case, on that premise, alliance is important to the United States. It's better to cope with others just by Americans, not only by Americans, but with allies. So I think he's already indicating the importance of NATO, Korea, and Japan to all those countries. We are going to continue to go along. Of course, there could be discussion of burden sharing that could come up, but the fundamental relations will not change. Then what will happen? I think on three fronts, policy may have to be watched. One, environment, as often people say. One, trade. Third, Middle East. Relations with Iran, the accord with Iran. One with the relations with Syria, IS may change. So I am personally watching those three elements, and that is not that predictable at this juncture. But the whole system structure, I am maybe a little optimistic, but would not collapse or shake or tremble as a lot of people now like to say. Now, of course, we can't still write clear picture, but I think we could be counting on his businessman instinct or sixth sense, saying which is better, which is better for America. I think the answer is obvious. Thank you very much, Jim.
Mr. Ambassador, thank you. And thank you very much for keeping within the 7 to 8 minute time frame that we've established. Our next speaker comes from Korea and is the chairman and CEO of one of the most important industrial groups, the Poongsan Group. We're listening now to Mr. Jinroy Yu.
Well, I'm a CEO of the company. CEO standing for Chief Entertainment Officer. Now, Mr. Trump, who was also a CEO, has to change from the Chief Entertainment Officer to the President of the United States. So that would be something worth watching. I would like to start by quoting some lines from this year's Nobel Prize winner in literature, Bob Dylan's song called "The Times They Are A-Changing," and I quote, "Come, senators, congressmen, please heed the call. Don't stand in the doorway, don't block up the hall, for he that gets hurt will be he who has stalled. There's a battle outside, and it is raging. It will soon shake your windows, and will rattle your walls, for the times, they are a-changing," unquote. This song was written by Bob Dylan more than 50 years ago, and yes, indeed, the times, they are a-changing. Finally, not only in the U.S. politics, but in the political and economic landscape around the world. We had the Brexit, the election of Duterte in the Philippines, and of course, Mr. Trump in the U.S. And what's next? Maybe President Le Pen in France, who knows? C'est vraiment possible. As an outside observer and not a participant in U.S. politics or election, I was fascinated by the outcome of the U.S. presidential election. In broad stroke, it revealed a couple of things. One, the American people are deeply concerned about the direction that their country is taking, especially economically, where the gap between the rich and the poor is growing. And even in the middle class, where the middle class is finding it difficult to make ends meet. Two, the desire for an outsider for president was more palpable than ever before. The American people were undeniably looking for a change in the economy, a change in immigration, and a change in addressing terrorism. So, since our topic today is about post-election, or more accurately, post-Obama, I would like to share some of my thoughts. First, internally, when President Trump takes office in January, you will see an immediate shift from a more liberal Obama policies to a very conservative Trump policies. As president, President Trump will be choosing at least the next two, and maybe even up to four of the next Supreme Court justices. He has said that he will appoint someone, some Supreme Court justice that are pro-life. And I'm sure he will also be against more gay rights. But it will really not make any difference because as some of the individual states in the U.S. allows abortions and gay marriages, I know President-elect Trump has said that he will leave it up to the states for these. I know many Americans were not happy about the election results, and they all inquired about the possibility of immigrating to Canada. But I don't think that will happen. You may see a lot of people moving to different states like California, Alaska, or Hawaii, as far as you can go from Washington, D.C. But probably the biggest change will be the Second Amendment, where there will be no major changes in the rights to have guns of any kind. I just want to add that my company makes bullets, and our company stock rose almost 20% since Trump got elected. So nobody's perfect. Since this is an international conference, I would like to focus on what kind of an impact incoming President Trump's policies will have in the world. President-elect Trump's campaign slogan, "Make America Great Again," captured the hearts of those who voted for him. Make America Great Again literally means America comes first. It's great news for those who live and do business in the U.S., but a big challenge for those who live and do business outside the U.S. As president, Mr. Trump will demand a level playing field, especially on trade issues. He has said that he will not do the Trans-Pacific Partnership and even threatened to pull out of NAFTA. One thing for sure is that there is going to be a lot of adjustment in the existing trade agreements U.S. has with many of the other countries. He will also be strict on currency manipulations as well. Regarding America's military bases around the world, he will ask countries like Japan, Korea, and Germany to pay more of the cost in the U.S. presence in their countries. He will also ask NATO countries to pay for most of the cost themselves instead of relying on the U.S. The biggest change that could happen, in my opinion, will be in the area of immigration. The Trump administration will be very tough on immigration, especially coming from Muslim countries and illegal immigrants from Mexico. The U.S. may even lower the quotas for immigration overall, as well as curtailing visas to travel to the U.S., not only for security reasons, but to preserve the jobs within the United States. So there isn't much good news for those outside of the U.S. compared to those who live in the U.S. But this is the reality and the platform on which Mr. Trump got elected as the 45th president of the United States. You mentioned about how the world feels, or the U.S. Feels about Mr. Trump getting elected. I don't think Americans are like Mr. Trump really gives a damn. It's all about America, so who cares what the other world thinks? The good news is that I think since his victory, President-elect Trump has been speaking with more caution and in a more conciliatory tone and demeanor. I'm hopeful that this changed approach is indicative of his desire to bring America together again and to be president to every American. I am also hopeful that after understanding the reality of what America faces in the world, President Trump will come to a realization that he and America will need the support of its allies and its friends to succeed and make America great again. For those of us who are not Americans, let's stop complaining about the outcome. Let's instead try to find out and see how we can work together with the new America to make this world a better place. I would like to conclude by my impersonation of Bob Dylan. If your time to you is worth saving, then you better start swimming or you're not. You're gonna sink like a stone, for the times they are a-changing. Thank you.
Thank you very much for working both Bob Dylan and a very strong dose of pragmatism into your remarks. We now have by audio link from Mexico, one of Mexico's most prominent businessmen, Juan Gallardo, who will now take the floor in absentia. Mr. Gallardo, are you
Thank
with
you.
Us? Yes, go ahead.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you very much, and it is indeed a great privilege to share the floor with such a distinguished panel. And as was already said, the timing is impeccable, though the transition is still in process. So many of the things that we can comment at this point, as has already been said, are a certain amount of, I might call, sort of educated conjecture. But over the next 6 days, we'll see much more clarity. To understand sort of North American, and I mean the NAFTA world, I think I would like to divide it into three quick comments. One is a state of Mexico. Second would be a comment on the border and how it's operational, world suspense, and finally, more importantly, going to the very distinctive case of NAFTA and its future. In the case of the Mexico update, very briefly, very quickly, Mexico has undergone a massive transformation in the last 3 years. Reforms that we had been searching for and fighting for over the last 25 years have all been now put in place. Opening up of energy, labor law, a new education bill, telecommunications, etc. I mean, there has been a massive legal and structural change within the country, which of course will take time to for things to work themselves through the system, transform, but that are already setting stage for a future that I think is aligned with all of us are interested in. A very interesting part of this just in the next couple of weeks when the final bids on deep drilling will be opened and we'll have a chance to have a real sense of just how much interest we were able to attract. Mexican growth, reasonable, balanced budget, despite an oil significant oil drop. Mexico has undergone from being an oil economy, 30% of its interest, to down to 14%. And that was achieved in terms of balance by a new reform, which was a lot of cost. Anyway, basically good news on the financial side, good solid news. Where are the challenges? We have a great battle undergoing right now with major legal challenge in terms of corruption. We continue to have cartel battles in terms of the drug force, political positioning for the 2018 elections, and of course, the big challenge, transition in the U.S. Let me address the border situation. I'm sure many of you, but just to give you a sense of its size, 1 million people cross that border every day, and more than 300,000 vehicles. So it's there's also more Mexicans coming back to Mexico than going to the U.S. now for at least 2 or 3 years running. So the idea of having an efficient border, a well-controlled border, a properly monitored border has been alive and working strongly. I have here a list of 15 very specific initiatives that are all occurring. The agreement of Homeland Security and underway now for a couple of years. So pointing in the same direction, we all want an efficient border, and we are thinking of strategic, what we call strategic, and obviously a lot to do with custom harmonization. So there are solutions beyond the wall or the fence. There's a clear understanding that we want to make sure that we have an operational, efficient border. Now, in terms of immigration, we will have a very strong stand in terms of things being done in a humane way. The figures have been dropping in terms of how many may or may not be deported. We shall see. The focus seems to be on anyone who has a criminal record, which sounds perfectly justifiable. As long as things are done in a very humane way, and I think we will be able to work our way through the famous wall discussion. We are very much aligned in the interest of ensuring that both sides are comfortable with what is needs to be done. And we'll see as the different appointments occur in the next few weeks, we'll see how much is needs to be done beyond what is already underway. Now, NAFTA question. I think it's interesting to mention the fact that three-way trade between Canada, U.S., and Mexico is more than $1 trillion a year. $1 trillion a year. 30 of the 53 states of the United States have Mexico as its number one or two trading partner. More than 6 million jobs in the U.S. are directly attributed to trade with Mexico. There is $250 billion of U.S. investment in Mexico. Mexico buys more than $250 billion from the U.S. every year, and more than 40% value added of products leaving Mexico for other markets incorporate 40% of U.S. value. When we first discussed NAFTA 20 plus years ago, we were dealing with promises. We're dealing with realities, and I think there is a level of integration between the three countries that is extremely important not to ignore. As you know, there is a clause. When the clause was discussed years ago, there's a clause for exit, and that clause is what we called at the time the nuclear solution. The reason being that you could, within 6 months' notice, step out of NAFTA, but it was all or nothing. And the reason for the all or nothing is that you do not want to generate a sort of a trickle-down effect little by little of an undoing, but rather make sure that all of those who have invested, who have integrated, who have benefited, were on the line also at the same time. So all that is where we stand right now. I think that as we look at NAFTA, as you look at any document that you reread after 25 years, there are very many clear areas that we can do, prove, modernize, deepen, expand, etc. What was the original agreement? Things related to enforcement, the dispute settlement system can be clearly strengthened. Environment and worker rights, clearly strengthened. In fact, already contemplated in the TPP. Everything that has to do with simplification, kind of paperwork that is required to establish the rules of origin is just outrageously slow and deep, and it can be very simplified. Things like commerce and energy, which weren't in the original NAFTA, and e-commerce didn't even exist, are obviously enhanced. So there's room, there's plenty of room to discuss constructively a more efficient NAFTA. And we certainly look forward to doing that with the new administrations. I think that what has been heard, what I think is would be very sad, is if the TPP effort were to be lost in the byway. Because okay, over the last 2 or 3 years, enormous community effort from the countries involved in TPP have gone into place. And I think that that momentum, as I understood from the APEC meeting in Lima last couple of days ago, clearly everyone would like to see that momentum be maintained with or without participation at this point of time. So we'll see what happens there. But I think all in all, in the case of North America, it's all about North American competitiveness. I think all three have been able to integrate to such a degree precisely because of that. And we certainly feel that there's room for discussion, constructive discussion with whoever comes into those positions in the next transition. I share the concerns that have been voiced before. Hopefully the rhetoric that occurred during the electoral process changes to a more pragmatic and constructive discussions, but time will tell and we are ready. Thank you very much.
Mr. Gallardo, thank you. I'm struck again by the very pragmatic tone of your remarks and the willingness to find a way through problems that have been raised mostly on this side of the border. We now move from the world of business to the world of ideas. Our first speaker will be Vuk Jeremic, who's happens to be from Serbia, which, according to public opinion polls, holds a rare distinction of having supported Donald Trump about 90%. Vuk, perhaps you can explain that and many other things to us. So the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Jim, for this introduction, and it's a great privilege and pleasure to be back at the World Policy Conference. I do come from Serbia, and Serbia is not your typical country when it comes to the analysis of the post. When it comes to the analysis of the post-American elections, the brand Clinton is not a terribly popular and strong brand in Serbia, and therefore this outlying data point that is called Serbia. So I'd rather try and concentrate on the broader European view and perhaps certain other parts of the world. The previous speakers put it succinctly. There's a lot of uncertainty as to what's going to happen. It is really, really difficult to predict, but one thing that looks more or less likely is that at least there is going to be an attempt at a different kind, building a different kind of relationship with Russia. And that is causing consternation in certain parts of Europe, especially in the eastern part. Also, people in Western Europe aren't terribly comfortable. Mr. Destin spoke about the upcoming referenda and elections in Western Europe. Of course, one can see how the election victory of Donald Trump may serve as a boost to populist movements, ideas, candidates in those elections, and that's certainly true. I'm sad to say that despite having written a piece on Brexit prior to Brexit, when I argued very strongly for Britain to remain in the European Union, I did predict that Brexit was going to happen. Something very, very similar happened with the election of Donald Trump. When I ran for the Secretary General of the United Nations earlier this year, I put in my platform policies that are totally opposite from the things that Donald Trump has been advocating for in his campaign. I did also, nevertheless, one day before the election, say that I don't think that Hillary looks too strong. My friends from Britain and my friends from the U.S. Were telling me, oh, don't be such a Serbian, it's never going to happen. Well, I am sorry to say that I was right. But I would not underestimate what Mr. Destin was saying. I think that we might be heading in Europe for more electoral victories that until recently we could not have imagined. But there's also a little bit of a self-fulfilling prophecy in the European attitude, which I hope is going to wither away as we move forward. I don't think that it necessarily has to be a disaster. First and foremost, I don't think that trying to make a different kind of relationship with Russia is necessarily a bad thing. There are probably going to be people who win more and people who win less or lose out of that new relationship. I think it's going to work, at least short term. I think this is something that Donald Trump is going to try, and I think that Mr. Putin is going to do his best to make sure that this attempt is successful, at least short term. I'm not talking about the long term. Long term, of course, previous speakers spoke about personal relationships versus countries' interests. Of course, countries' interests and strategic interests are something that in the end of the day usually prevail. But probably one of the first repercussions of a Russia-U.S. rapprochement would be the two countries working more closely together in Syria, and that thing is going to bring about, in my opinion, a world of opportunities. And despite the fact that this is opposite kind of attitude to the one that Barack Obama had with regard to Russia. Effectively, it's not strategically very different when it comes to the context of the Middle East. Obama spoke about the balance of power in his latest big interview to Mr. Goldberg. I think that the balance of power just gets accelerated with the Russia-America trying to work closely together in Syria and beyond. If they're successful in bringing to a halt the Syrian debacle, and I'm not going to get into the details as to what could be the parameters of that closure, but if there is something that looks like armistice, if not peace, it's going to open a world of opportunities. It could open up a possibility of looking again at the Israel-Palestine situation. Don't forget that Donald Trump mentioned that once that this is the toughest deal in the world, and I'm good at making deals. It's not inconceivable that he might try and do that upon starting a different kind of relationship with the Russians. One can talk about a whole world. Others are here much more knowledgeable about other parts of the world. But I think, and this is the last thing that I'm going to say, we should try and wake up to the new reality. We shouldn't be lamenting about what could have gone differently. Our friend from Mexico spoke about his hope that the TPP is not going to go away. It's dead. It won't happen. Let's not continue behaving as if nothing had happened. There was a very, very decisive result of the American election. We are going to live in a different world as a result of that. Let's try and concentrate on the opportunities and not fall into the trap of making negative self-fulfilling prophecies.
Thank you very much, Fu. We turn now for a final view from abroad to our friend Mr. Wang Jisi, who has at various conferences that I've been to over the past few years has proved to be a very reliable guide to what China is likely to think about something and do about something. So the floor is yours, sir.
Thank you, Chair. Coming from China, I would like to say that the last election in the United States was not only controversial and divisive in the United States, but it is also divisive in China. A country which is politically remote and politically dissimilar to the United States. Well before the US election, China's official media had carried numerous editorials and commentaries in a familiar tone. In the People's Daily, the most authoritative newspaper of the Communist Party, a few very simple words were frequently used to describe the election process: nasty, chaotic, bad, low, conspiracy, vote buying, corruption, demonizing, unpopularity, etc. A commentary published in the People's Daily on November 8th argued, whoever wins the U.S. election, it will by no means be the victory of democracy. The message to Chinese people is clear. America's political system and values provide nothing for China to admire or to follow. Unlike most other countries, probably with the exception of Serbia and Russia, the majority of China's media and political elites appear to tilt toward Donald Trump rather than Hillary Clinton during the campaign. They had made the right prediction of Trump's victory. With very few exceptions, most of those sympathetic to Trump have no direct access to US media because of the internet firewall and the language barrier.
Mr. Wang, could I ask you to just pull your microphone in a little bit more?
They get information only from the Chinese media, including social media. Those who made the right direction did not have access to American media. Those Chinese scholars and analysts, including myself, who watched the presidential election closely by way of following U.S. media and talking to their American counterparts, generally got their predictions wrong. These three reasons can be found to explain why many Chinese people preferred Trump. First, some like Trump's ideas of protecting indigenous industries and trade protectionism, or were fond of his expressive defiance against political correctness in America related to feminism, homosexuality, multiculturalism, ethnic and religious diversity, etc. These Chinese noticed that Trump tended to speak on behalf of the older blue-collar workers in rural areas. And China also has populations suffering from similar gaps between rich and poor, and between cosmopolitan cities and the countryside. They argue that China should learn something from Trump's insistence in protecting manufacturing capacities and preventing financial assets from going out of the country. They loathe what is known as LGBT, as the LGBT is against Chinese traditional values. According to their understanding, China should resist the tide of immigration from Africa and the Middle East into China when a large number of Africans are now residing in the city of Guangzhou and many merchants from the Middle East have found their homes in Southeast China. In addition, some Chinese argue that national minorities in China, like American blacks and the new immigrants, have enjoyed too many privileges at the expense of the mainstay of the population. To put it simply, Trump's supporters in China are using his ideas and slogans as reference to China. The second grouping of the Trump supporters in China took note of his ideological color in comparison with Hillary Clinton's emphasis on promoting U.S. values in the world. Trump's America's First slogan sounded inward-looking, unlike Clinton's internationalism. What is more, Trump said he liked the Russian leader Putin, who is arguably the most popular foreign leader in China. Trump's statements during the campaign seemed that he might be less committed to U.S. security alliances with Japan and South Korea and would rescind the TPP negotiations, making the president-elect likely to depart from traditional U.S. security and economic policies toward Asia. Therefore, many Chinese believe a Trump administration will be less hostile, if not more friendly, to China. On top of all considerations, as these Chinese understood, Trump is a tycoon who loves money, and China has a lot of money. Thus, it must be easier to make a deal with Trump. Some other Chinese hailed Trump's victory not because they like him, but because they dislike the United States. It is their expectation that the Trump administration with a Republican Congress may do a lot of harm to the U.S. by making it less unified, less powerful, and more isolated in the world. A weakened United States, they hope, would not be able to interfere forcefully in China's domestic affairs and constrain China's international space. Most of those Chinese who did not express delight at Trump's victory also look at U.S. Election implications for China. Some in business circles are concerned that a new surge of protectionism in America might hurt China's business interests abroad. More broadly, as a few leading Chinese economists argue, the world after the US election and the Brexit will witness the increase in resistance to globalization in different regions, especially in Europe. China has been one of the largest beneficiaries of economic globalization, and the next step of reform and opening will continue to depend on open markets and free interflow of capital. Any reversal of globalization may impede China's economic growth. It is noted among Chinese analysts that uneven distribution of wealth reflecting higher Gini indexes everywhere in the world has been a root cause of rising populism. But they see no easy solution to this inequality, and there is not much the United States can do to ease the popular anger and anxieties. On the political side of the Trump phenomenon, sober-minded scholars in China point to the possibility of the world moving into a renewed period of strongman politics, which could result in more stringent control of society and information interflow. As a veteran US watcher in China in the last three decades, I was numbed in Beijing when I got the news that Trump had won. It shattered my confidence in analyzing US politics, as the vast majority of US media, as well as all the Americans I had talked to about the election during the campaign, had been somewhat misleading. What stunned me was not only the outcome of the election, but more importantly, how the United States has been politically divided and wounded in different dimensions: cultural, ethnic, racial, social class, religious, gender, age, and partisan. I used to be consistently confident that the United States, despite all the problems it has, will not be a declining power, but I'm not too sure of it today. Would the election be the birthday of this United States of America, or would it mark the beginning of revival of the United States, or making America great again, as the Trump slogan says? I don't really know. Finally, I don't want to spend too much time to discuss US-China relations in the post-election era. Nothing is certain at the moment. Whatever Trump thinks about China, his China policy is likely to be handled by some hawkish officials and advisors. So there's a contradiction between what he thinks about China and what his advisors think about China. There will be about 6 months ahead to figure out who they are. I would be surprised if Beijing appeared to be proactive during this transitional period. Thank you.
It will not surprise you to know that Henry Kissinger would agree with your closing remarks. Absolutely. That China will take at least 6 months to study what you have outlined quite perceptively as probably an opportunity for China. Our next speaker represents a different segment. As Mr. Wang went through the list of reasons why he perceived the possibility that Donald Trump would win, I thought they were the same reasons that we in the media establishment in America saw as why the reasons why Hillary would win. So it's been a period of real soul searching in the media in the United States to figure out how we got the election results, or how we didn't get them right, to put it mildly, but how America has changed so much that there are parts of America we in the media didn't seem to recognize. So. Our final presentation comes from a younger American, who is very active in the world of blogs and online journalism. It's Ryan Evans, who is the founder of War on the Rocks and the chief editor of War on the Rocks, who will give us the perspective of perhaps a different segment of America.
Thanks so much for having me. I'm going to try to make it interesting. Unfortunately, I'm not going to sing like my co-panelists. I think, to be pretty candid, we have to be prepared for a range of outcomes. It's very difficult to predict what can happen, and I think that range of outcomes is very broad. I think it starts with something akin to the George W. Bush administration, but perhaps more disorganized and with an extra side of mayhem. And on the other end of the spectrum, I think we actually have to be prepared for the breakdown of democracy in the United States, and perhaps even the introduction of some sort of autocracy. And if you think I'm being too extreme, witness President-elect Trump's recent comment on how we absolutely, it's his word, need to register Muslims living in the United States. And think how, just think how new of a problem that is for us to be dealing with, to have an American person that is about to be the United States president saying something like that openly, and have his chief of staff then go on TV the next day and say we can't rule that out. And I think something we've seen in the development of past autocratic systems, which is not to say that's definitely what we're seeing now, but again, we need to be prepared for the possibility, is you don't just see top-down policy changing and hardening society, but you see people that are that consider themselves the followers of the leader working towards what that man says. And Donald Trump says a lot of things, and then he contradicts himself the next day, and then he says it again. As he says, he, quote-unquote, has the best words. But when you constantly say extreme things, and if people are working to realize your vision, that makes many things permissible, not just in the federal bureaucracy, but in American society. So I think a lot of this really hinges on whether the answer to two questions. Is Donald Trump the megalomaniacal borderline psychopath that he plays on television? Yes or no? And can our institutions restrain him? And you know, if the answer to that first question is yes, and the answer to that second question is no, then we have a problem. Maybe I'm being alarmist, but I think these are valid questions. As far as how it affects US policy towards the world, again, we have a range of options. I think what we're already seeing develop in the transition and the appointment of the national security team are two factions, and this is consistent with how Trump has run his businesses, as he creates these sort of two internal factions and pits them against each other. We have what I'll call the Priebus faction, named after the person he's appointing as his chief of staff, and the Bannon faction, the head of Breitbart, who's the chief strategist. The first faction represents the more Republican, the more establishment part of the Republican Party, and the second represents what's come to be called the alt-right, more extreme voices. And I think, I predict, you know, my predictions have been worth pretty much nothing this election cycle, but I predict he will split his appointments fairly evenly between those two camps, which will create a lot of internal tension on major questions of policy, and then whichever faction sort of wins out will determine policy in that area. And I really think a lot of the major policy questions have been discussed on this panel, but I think the biggest one are the United States' approach towards international trade and its relationship with China, which I actually think will be far more determinative of what the world looks like than its relationship with Russia. I don't think Donald Trump has an ideology on foreign policy. I think he has strong antipathies, and that makes him all the more unpredictable. He's expressed a lot of antipathy towards China. He's accused China of doing everything from destroying industrial America, fabricating climate change, which is my favorite. But he also doesn't express a huge amount of discomfort with what China is doing in the South China Sea. So it could very well be that we see an administration that is very aggressive on trade and waging some sort of a trade war, trade protectionism targeting China, but is also willing to accommodate what China views as its interests in South and East China Seas. I think that sort of all options are open at this point, and a lot will be determined by the fights within these between these factions and the sort of cauldron of Trump's ego. And finally, I want to say, I was asked to say something about how someone of my generation views this issue. I'm just barely a millennial. I was born in 1983. I don't like to admit to being a millennial, but I suppose I am. But I will tell you that a lot of my friends, and I'm an independent, I'm not a Democrat or a Republican, but a lot of my friends on both sides of the aisle of my generation sort of express the same profound disappointment with those who came before us, and particularly the baby boomers, who we don't really view as being good stewards of our country's power and general affairs. I was, I'll skip that story. But I do think that is something that there's a real generational divide in the United States in how we approach politics and how we approach the economy and how we approach entitlements, benefits, social issues, and I think you're going to start seeing that come into sharper relief over the next 4 years. Finally, I'll just close with one question. I had the misfortune of being around a table with a bunch of political scientists before I came here. If this was an audience of historians, you all would have laughed at that one. But one of them made the really good point is this really puts to the test the sort of great man theory of international relations. Is a country's trajectory and choices really about agency of the man on top or woman on top? Or is it about structural issues and the structure of the international system? And I think the next 4 years will perhaps be the best case study we have for that question than we've had in a long time. And so I'll just close there, and I look forward to your questions.
Ryan, thank you, and thank you for skipping the story since we're very short on time. We're going to try to work in 15 to 20 minutes of question if I can borrow some time from the next panel. Thierry is indicating perhaps not, so let's keep it short. So if you could identify yourself, and we'll start right here, and keep your questions as brief as possible, and please don't use your time to make comments. Just ask questions, please.
Thank you. I think the panel was extremely interesting, particularly that after the post-US elections. What I want to ask Mr. Hoagland in particular, last year you said about the US disengaging completely from the Middle East, and Mr. Obama has underlined this in the Obama Doctrine in his interview with Goldberg. As you know, and I don't know if you know, but in the Middle East, the reactions to Mr. Trump's election is totally different from the West. In fact, he was acclaimed. One of the first ones to congratulate him was the Egyptian president. And people are cautiously optimistic, let's say, that relations with the Arab world will be different than what Mr. Obama has said. What do you think it will be with Mr. Trump? Is there reason for optimism, or is it just wishful thinking? Thank you.
Thank you, Mona, for that question. And I'll briefly respond and then see if there's anybody on the panel who wants to take it on. I did talk in the past about Obama treating the Middle East as a burning building that he wanted to flee after his experiences there. I think in general, we're going to see a continuation under Donald Trump of the tendency to have less America rather than more America in foreign affairs. Trump is going to be absorbed by the internal divisions that the panel has described very well, has perceived very well, and so far has not shown a lot of interest in the classical foreign policy games, the balance of power games that we know about. I think, again, the Middle East should look on Trump, the first 6 months in particular, as an opportunity to get in there and to influence him and to try to get him more involved, perhaps. But I'm not sure you'll be successful. Did anybody want to take that on? Let's move on to the next question then. Did I see a yes? Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much for your interesting comments. I have a quick comment and a question. I think the problem isn't just Trump, it's Trump's picks. We have Mike Flynn, we have Steve Bannon, and we have Mike Pompeo. They're all hard, hawkish war advocates, and some of them even was criticizing President Obama for ending the interrogation technique, the program of interrogation technique. I'm wondering, how would that influence U.S. image when you have people like these three gentlemen who advocate interrogation, waterboarding, and amongst other things? How would that also influence the war on terror, since you may have read or heard ISIS have been cheering for Donald Trump's win, saying that it's going to make their job easier? So I was wondering if anyone has an answer to that. Thank you.
Ryan, that falls right into your wheelhouse, if you could give us a quick answer.
Yeah, I think that's a really important question. What's interesting about, so a few months ago, Trump gave a, you know, a big foreign policy speech, his second big foreign policy speech, and it was billed as how he was going to see the world, and it was all about terrorism. It was, all of it, his single, the single organizing factor of how Trump at least seems to view the world in terms of global strategy is about the issue of terrorism, which I think is really interesting and dangerous. As far as the sort of moral and questions that you bring up about torture and things like that, I think it's an open question. I can tell you that in Washington, there are a lot of people talking about the ethics of serving in this administration, and that's mostly playing out publicly among people likely to be political appointees, but I can also tell you there are a lot of people in government, civil servants in our agencies, who are talking openly about, well, what's my red line? At what point do I resign? Because we're not going to go back and do these things again. But if the Trump administration does decide to go in that direction and reinstitute torture, you know, Trump has said publicly many times that actually he, not only does he think waterboarding is not only does he think waterboarding is torture, he thinks it is torture, but he thinks it's not enough, that we need to go further. And while I do think there'll be a lot of resignations and a lot of public pressure as a result of that, and hopefully some congressional pushback, which will be more likely after the midterms if the Democrats are able to win back some more seats, I still think he's going to be able to find people in the federal bureaucracy willing to carry out those policies. And I think that will be terrible. Just a complete catastrophe. And I wish I had something more comfortable to say than that. But I just think a moment about a president who sees the world entirely through the prism of counterterrorism. He doesn't really understand or maybe care too much about the idea of great power competition. And I think that's a pretty scary situation to be in.
Well, Jeremic has a very...
Well, I think we're definitely moving away from the attitude of liberal internationalism of the United States of America and by extension of the wider world. But it is the way it is. And I understand that people are eagerly expecting for the first speech of President Donald Trump. But again, I wouldn't put too much premium on speeches. Arguably, one of the best speeches in history was Cairo speech of President Barack Obama. And very little came as a follow-up to that speech. I believe, and briefly addressing the first question, which I also tried to answer, I think that there is an opportunity here, and that the attitude that he says that he is going to have towards resolving world affairs is probably something that would work well with at least the number of actors that are currently present in the Middle East, the Middle Eastern actors, as well as the external ones who do have influence together with America.
Thank you. This is Mr. Hoagland. And as I have a question to you, this is Mr. Hoagland and then Evans. The presidential campaign this time is very much exciting, and a lot of money is spent. But finally, the number of votes in the United States are less than the previous presidential election. How do you analyze about that? And it's in addition to that, I wasn't aware, but I found that the Supreme Court decision of 2010 saying that the legal corporation has no limit the spending money on the campaign or for the political activities. Does it really affect this election? And I don't think this Supreme Court decision will be overruled anytime from now on, since because of the Republicans, the majority in the Senate and the House of Representatives both. At that time, such a Supreme Court decision may have a certain impact for the coming elections and so on. Thank you very much.
I think in this particular case, in this election, the Supreme Court decision on corporate donations to political candidates did not play a significant role because Donald Trump spent very little on traditional campaigning methods. Hillary spent a great deal, but it didn't produce the results desired. I think this vote, by and large, has to be seen as a rejection by the nation of the way things are, a rejection of experts, a rejection really of institutions as well, and of these two particular candidates. And I think that explains why the vote was down, these candidates, neither of whom stirred a great deal of enthusiasm, in my view. Ryan, did you want to briefly add to that?
Yeah, I'll just point to what I think is a larger issue that encompasses what you asked about. So sort of two complementing issues, actually. So the first is we have in our country a very powerful executive, and we also have norms where sort of things that you wouldn't expect to be that you would expect to be regulated are not regulated. So for example, when foreign visitors come to observe American elections, they're always surprised by the fact that Americans do not have to show identification when they vote. They show up at their local polling place, they say who they are, and they vote. And foreign visitors are always surprised by that, and then we say, well, our system's just so strong, and we have these norms in place, and we all trust each other, and everything's fine, and that's why it works. But the sort of trust that underlies that system and those norms are starting to wear away. And at the same time, we have less space between the passions of the masses and the legislative branch and the people that get voted into the executive than we ever have before. And what I mean by that is the rise of the primary systems, referendums being used more commonly. You could even go back to early in the 20th century when direct election to the Senate was instituted instead of state legislators picking senators. All these things are diminishing the space between popular passions and the state actually deciding on major things. And I think that as that happens and as trust and our norms erode, we're starting to see the larger system erode.
I want to thank this excellent panel and the questions from the audience. Be assured that we will carry the word back as to your impressions of the United States at this point. Thank you very much.